across the Nile and the deserts of Egypt, heading for those distant lands. Abdelrahman brought culture and learning from the centre of the Islamic world straight to the heart of Al-Andalus.
When Abdelrahman arrived in Spain, he came here to Cordoba, where the city was in complete disarray. That Roman bridge had collapsed into the river, but Abdelrahman set to rebuilding the city. You have to remember that it's in this context that the Arabs arrive, not as marauding destroyers, but sometimes as saviors.
Abdelrahman brought cutting-edge technology for irrigation to Spain. Almost immediately, the landscape was transformed. Palm trees, lemon and orange groves, avocados, artichokes and pomegranates, none of which had been seen in Europe. Because of Abdelrahman's sophisticated trade network, this new agriculture created huge wealth. And these riches were used to build one of the greatest cities in the world. While the inhabitants of London were still living in wooden houses, the people of Cordoba had built a cosmopolitan city with a population of over 100,000, the largest settlement in Europe. Reports from European visitors to Cordoba describe a city with 70 libraries and over 300 public baths. The accounts tell of houses with running water and roads illuminated by streetlights.
You often have to take medieval sources with a fairly substantial pinch of salt because chroniclers were extremely fond of exaggeration. But in fact, the new excavations here at Cordoba are actually revealing a city that was just as rich as the one that they described. These monumental palace walls belong to a Muslim aristocrat, and this channel over here is part of the water system that brought Cordoba its famously effective sewage works, as well as the fountains and the baths that so impressed all those European visitors.
Cordoba was described by a 10th century German visitor as the ornament of the world.
One of the reasons it's been so difficult to investigate Islamic Cordoba is that the city's been built up on itself like a kind of layer cake. But here, the archaeologists have taken away the modern level to reveal that Islamic layer there, and then down at the bottom, a Roman mosaic.
Abdelrahman built Cordoba on top of what had been one of the largest cities in Roman Spain, outshining all that went before. And his greatest achievement was this: the Great Mosque of Cordoba. With a floor space the size of four football pitches, this is the largest mosque in Western Islam. The forest of 600 marble columns disappear into the distance, creating a mesmeric infinity effect. On the columns, arches balance on top of one another. Its shell-shaped prayer niche has an extraordinary acoustic, making any word spoken inside audible to the entire congregation.
When the mosque was first built, these archways would have been opened to allow people and light to stream in and out. And this courtyard was a central part of the complex. People would come here to ritually purify themselves before they worshipped, or just to gossip and do business.
Abd al-Rahman's original mosque was only a fraction of the size of the building that stands today. Over a period of 200 years, rulers would extend the mosque three times. It's been suggested that the mosque was enlarged because each new ruler of the city wanted to stamp his authority on the building. But there's also a more straightforward explanation. The Cordoba Mosque had to accommodate the burgeoning number of worshippers. The Muslim population of Spain was growing fast. Modern Spain has been reluctant to acknowledge that its indigenous population converted to Islam in droves.
The standard history books present the Muslim occupation of Spain as something that was superficial, just a surface colonisation by an Arab elite, not a presence that had any kind of lasting impact on the bulk of the population. New archaeological evidence is turning that idea on its head.
All over Spain, cities like Cordoba were established. Even Madrid was founded by Muslims. The original Arab walls still stand behind the Royal Palace.
How far did Muslim communities spread through Spain?
We see remains dating from the time of Al-Andalus almost everywhere, not only in the south of Spain, but also in other parts of Spain. There are emerging lots of sites, fortresses, villages and cities almost everywhere. People were Arabized, losing the form of Latin they were speaking into them, and they were Islamized in the sense that they dropped Christianity and converted to Islam in massive numbers, really.
Were these forced conversions, or was the idea of Islam particularly attractive?
It's always very difficult to say why someone converts to another religion, isn't it? But I think there is no evidence of any forced conversion at all. In a way, the Islamization and Arabization of territories like Al-Andalus is very similar to what happened to the Roman Empire when people wanted to convert to the values and to the cultural values, to the religious values, and to the way of living of what seemed to be a civilization which had lots of advantages.
I think it's very easy to forget that at this moment in time, Islam is a culture of innovation, isn't it? As you said, it's drawing in ideas from the East.
It's a culture of phenomenal innovation. The opportunities of living because of the market, because of the trade relations and so on, which were much more interesting.
The Islamization of Spain did more than change the name of the god that people worshipped. People converted because this was a religion which had something to offer them. It had wealth, it had social structure, and it had intellectual power.
The Arabs brought in one innovation that did more than any other to change the cultural makeup of Europe. And it's this: paper. The idea almost certainly came from the Chinese via trade exchange, and it is revolutionary technology. Unlike parchment and vellum, it's cheap and it's easy to mass produce. And when the Arabs come to Spain, they start to open paper-making factories. Paper allows you to do three things very effectively. You can gather information, you can analyse and develop ideas in a very precise way, and then you can disseminate your newfound knowledge to a wider world. And in the 10th century, that was a potent mix.
Cordoba's love of books became legendary. Whilst the Royal Library of France contained 900 books in this period, just one of Cordoba's 70 libraries amassed over 500,000. These books contain some of the most sophisticated studies of astronomy in the world.
In Northern Europe at this time, there is nothing. But there is nothing that can be considered the result of sophisticated astronomy.
Why do you think Muslim scholars were particularly interested in the heavens and the revolution of the stars?
I think they were interested in science in general terms. For example, calculating the sacred direction. If you have to say your prayers, you must face towards Mecca. Calculating the direction of Mecca from a given place is not so easy. It is a complicated mathematical problem for which the Arabs had exact solutions from the 9th century.
One of the ways in which the Muslims solved these problems was by developing a Greek instrument called the astrolabe. This is a calculator for telling the time of night or day.